I'd like to talk about love is friendship. And I don't have a text, but I have a thought, my thoughts. A Sunday school teacher one time asked her class, why is it wrong for a man to have two wives? And one of the children said, well, because Jesus said no man can serve two masters. That was insightful. She said, what did Jesus have to say about marriage? The little boy said, he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. I want to talk about friendship. Friendship is a powerful word. Sometimes it's overlooked, but it's the glue that holds relationships together. We start off learning to be friends in the sandbox. And then as we get older, we fine-tune it. We figure out who's a good friend and who's not a good friend. What's the kind of friend I want? What's the kind of friend I don't want? We learn as we go, but we start off at the very beginning.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got trouble, and I got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We stick together, see it through, 'cause you've got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
I received a Valentine's Day card years ago from a little girl by the name of Heather. I kept it because I thought it was cute. You got two monkeys and you got banana peels on their head. And then the statement, you have a certain appeal. I look at that and I think to myself, you know, when you have a friend, the friend doesn't really see handsome or pretty. Friend sees something different. Friend sees a connection. So I'm thinking, wonder what she meant when she sent me this little Valentine's Day, because I wonder if she was thinking I look like a monkey. Or I thought it was cute, and it's been years that I've kept that. Valentine's Day started, nobody knows for sure when, but they do think it may have been the year 270 AD. The Roman emperor was persecuting Christians because he demanded that every person in the empire honored 12 gods. Christians could not do that. So Christians were rounded up and they were thrown into jail to be executed. One of them was Valentinus. Thrown into prison, and while he was in prison, the jailer got to know him and they became friends. One day the jailer came to him and said, you know, I have a daughter, Julia is her name, and she's blind, but she's quick with her thinking and she could use a teacher. Now, Valentinus was a teacher as well as a minister. So that he agreed to teach his daughter, Julia, history, Roman history, mathematics, and God. And so he spent time with a little blind Julia and teaching her her lessons. And the day came, it was February the 14th, the year 270 AD, when he was executed. He left a note for Julia, simply said this, stay close to God, your Valentine. And from then on, we have been celebrating Valentine's Day. The idea of Valentine's Day is to let your friends know you love them, let them know you care. And we live in a day and age when technology is incredible because we've got social media that can span the globe and you can stay connected with anybody. We've got Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, all this social media, and isn't it ironic that with all of that technology, we are more disconnected and divided than ever before. We're divided by color. white and black, blue states, red states, left, right, divided by the vaccinated, the unvaccinated, the masked, and the unmasked. And it goes on. So divided, yet we have social media that is designed to keep us so connected. The truth of the matter is it's friendship that holds relationships together. It's the glue that keeps people together. And you know, I've done a lot of counseling in my years and performed a lot of weddings. When two people come in for counseling, there's no doubt in my mind that they are friends. They care about each other. And the issue is not do you care about each other before you get married, but do you care about each other after you get married? Because that is really where the real test is. I received a letter from a girl that the letter sounds so wonderful, but it ends up so tragic. I want you to see this. A desire for friendship. Simply put this way, I always wanted to find a man that I could trust, someone that would be my best friend, someone who loved me just for myself, someone I could talk to, someone I could talk to about God, someone who cares about me and what I feel, someone who really likes me and wants to spend time with me. This is what I really want. The tragedy is she never did find it, for whatever reasons. And so often what happens, when the next counseling session comes in, I hear things like, he doesn't care about me. I don't even think he loves me. I'm not important. Everything I bring to the table is negative. And I don't feel like I belong. The thing about marriage is that when a person is married, they need to continue the friendship factor. So many times we talk about do you love each other and it's important to love each other, but it's friendship that starts it all. And we need to strive to keep that friendship in the marriage. I want to share something with you that comes from the Bible and it comes from the life of Job. And it deals with friendship that went south. Job had friends, the scripture calls them friends. And they came to comfort Job in his misery and his misfortune. He lost everything, his possessions, his children, his home, even his wife. And this is what the scripture says in Job 2, verse 11. It says, now when Job's three friends, the Bible seems to go out of its way to point out the fact that they were his friends, they heard of all his adversity that had come upon him. Each one came from his own place, for they had made an agreement together to come and mourn with him and to comfort him. That was their purpose. They came to help him. When it comes to friendship, you never kick somebody who's down. It goes without saying. And if you kick somebody who's up, they're not a friend. But that's what happened to Job. They came to mourn. They came to put their arms around him. They came to tell him they cared. They accused him, mocked him, judged him, blamed him for the misfortune. Does that sound like a friend? So their friendship went sour. Sometimes even in marriages, friendship can go sour. What starts off as bliss can become blistered. What starts off as wedlock becomes deadlock. What starts off as helpmate becomes stalemate. And what starts off as prime rib becomes spare rib. Friendship. Friendship can go bad. And that's what happened to Job. Job is surrounded, he's in misery, he's hurting, his health is gone, and he's surrounded by three men that do nothing but accuse him and blame him for the misfortune that he is. That's not a friend. And then at the end of the book, God speaks to the friends. And he says, my servant Job shall pray for you. I read that and I think to myself, you want me to pray for guys like that? I'm going to pray, Father, Godfather, send Uncle Angelo to the likes of this. Pray. My servant Job shall pray. What's he going to say when he prays? Pray. Father, forgive them because they don't even know what they're talking about. Father, forgive them because they don't even understand what your will is. How's he going to pray? What is he going to say? My servant Job shall pray for you, for I will accept him, lest I deal with you according to your folly, because you have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has. You are wrong, he's right. You accused him, you are wrong. You blamed him, you were wrong. You don't even know what's going on. So my servant Job is going to pray for you. I think there's a song that was written about this. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? That's Job's friends. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Never think about taking the friends that have hurt you to the Lord in prayer. The ones who despisefully use you, the ones that say all manner of evil against you, falsely, for my sake, taking them to the Lord. But that's what the scripture, that's the reason why Job's in the Bible. I wouldn't be in the Bible because that's not the kind of prayer I would have prayed. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Don't you want to know that God is able to shield you even when you have friends like Job's? Thou wilt find a solace there. So the scripture says, when Job prayed, I don't think it's a mistake that the writer wrote, when Job prayed for his friends. I mean, if I was doing that, I'd put quotation marks around friends. But he's praying. This is the end of the book. He's praying for his friends. Then the Lord restored Job's losses. The Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. God blessed Job for being willing to pray for friends that were not friends. I think there's got to be a message in here somewhere, because there are times when those who we thought were friends are no longer friends, and we would like to put them on a shelf somewhere, but the scripture would not just, you know, pray for them. Pray for them. You don't know what God's going to do. And by the way, even if God doesn't do anything, he's going to bless you. And Job received a double portion for his being willing to pray for his friends. Toxic friendships, what are they? How do you know if a friendship is toxic? How do you know if there's a breakdown in a friendship? Because you can see a smile, but behind that smile, there could be anything but friendship. So how do we know? And I just want to share with you some of the things that could help us understand what a toxic friendship is like. Friendships that are toxic have way too much drama attached to them. Everything is wrong. The sky is always cloudy. There's never a blue sky. Everything is wrong. And when you're surrounded by everything is wrong and everything is negative and everything is pessimist, you've got the makings of a friendship that's going south. A toxic friendship is when somebody will talk behind your back. And if they do, it eventually, at times, will come right back to you. And you hear about it. A toxic friendship is one where a person warms up to you only because of something that they want. Then after they get what they want, they just walk away. Toxic. A toxic relationship is where there's no eye contact. No contact. They're looking above. They're looking to the right or to the left, but not you. And you know, there are times when I've seen people like this, that they're talking to me and they're looking, and I'm down here. I'm 5 feet, 9.5 inches down here. So one of the reasons you could have a toxic relationship is because you no eye contact. The other reason is you get too much eye contact. There's something overdone. And the too much eye contact comes across as, I demand your attention, and don't you look away because I am staring at you. Something is wrong with that. Our relationships need to be normal and they need to flow. A toxic relationship is someone who drains you physically and drains you emotionally. When you're through, you always feel totally exhausted. It's a sign of a toxic relationship. And everything is about them. This is a narcissistic personality. Everything is about me. Life centers around me. I am self-centered. It's all about, that's toxic. It's not a good friendship. I call these people the squirrel friendships because they'll drive you nuts. There's one thing about friendship, and that is friendships need to be maintained. If you take somebody for granted, what happens is the friendship begins to fade. So it needs to be, there needs to be some kind of a maintenance involved in keeping. Now you have a self-cleaning oven in your kitchen. That's wonderful. But you don't have a self-cleaning home. It's got to be maintained. You will never find a garden that maintains itself. It's got to be maintained. You got to do something in order to keep it. The same thing is true when it comes to friendships. You have to do something to keep the friendship maintained. I remember reading this. The Golden Gate Bridge is probably one of the longest bridges in the world, 8,981 feet long. That's like 30 football fields end to end. That is a long bridge. Now, because it spans seawater, they figured out that within 2 years, the salt content of the water would start to corrode the steel. So this is what they do. They start repainting the bridge, let's say in January. They start repainting the bridge in January, and every week for the entire year, they are painting, repainting this bridge until they come to the end. 52 weeks later, they finish painting the bridge. On the 53rd week, they start right here at the beginning again so that that bridge is always being painted. That's to keep the corrosion of the salt from destroying the steel. Friendships have to be maintained. I want to share a couple of thoughts with you about friendships, not because I'm an expert when it comes to friendships, but because I'm the pastor of the church. And I wanted to talk about friendship today. Why? Because tomorrow is Valentine's Day. This is a message to all husbands and all boyfriends and everybody else. They need to be reminded that tomorrow is Valentine's Day. There's something about a friendship I think it's important to know, and that is it's a level playing field. Whatever you bring to the table is considered equal. It's a very important concept. One of the problems in friendships is if somebody decides he or she is superior to the other person, and then another person might feel inferior because the person who is superior is making it known that he or she is superior. And what that does, it actually destroys the relationship. You might have an association, but you won't have a friendship. You can even have an employer-employee relationship on an uneven playing field, but you cannot have a relationship that is good, and you certainly cannot have a marriage unless you have a level playing field. And what it comes to is something like this. He or she comes with $1 million in a suitcase. It's fantasy, but $1 million in a suitcase. The other person comes with his or her talent, just themselves, and what they bring to offer. What they bring to each other is always considered a level playing field. We never use something that we have to make us feel superior to the other person. It's always level. Anytime it changes the elevation, the friendship is suffering. We have to accept the other person as equal. They have to accept us as equal. Now, you know, when it comes to people, sometimes we see somebody that needs some help, and so we go and step in to fix them, or we step in maybe to change them, or we step in to rescue them. And that's all well and good, nothing wrong with rescuing somebody, changing somebody, or fixing somebody, but that never works in a marriage. Never. Ever. Because what it does is it creates the illusion that one is superior and the other one is inferior, and there's resentment that's connected to that. So when we come together, you don't get married to fix somebody. That's a prescription for disaster. You don't get married to change somebody. You don't get married to rescue somebody. You get married because you love that person and because you have a friendship, and the friendship that begins ought to be the friendship that you continue to keep throughout the relationship. I was walking home, I was about 13 years old, walking home from a church service a Friday night, and in order to get home, we lived in the Bronx at the time, we had to take a subway, and it was dark, and there were some streets. All the streets were dark after I got off the subway. And I'm walking home. I was alone. My brother didn't go to church that day. And my sisters weren't with me. And I'm away home. About five or six guys surrounded me. And what we called, they jumped me. And it's what I remember. First of all, they were swearing at me. I didn't do anything to anybody. But suddenly now they're angry with me. And I didn't even know who these guys are. And they had cardboard rolls. And they started hitting me over the head with these cardboard. That's the reason why I can't find my glasses now. I misplaced my glasses and I'm looking for them. I think that's the reason why those guys were hitting me over the head. Well, anyway, what happened was finally they left me and I continued walking home. And I got home, my brother was in bed, and I told him what happened. And this is what happened. He did. He jumped out of bed, jumped into his pants, slipped on his shoes, and said, "Where are they?" And he walked out the door before I had a chance to figure out what was going on. So I walked out with him. And we walked out the street, and we walked to the place where they jumped me, and we saw five or six guys. And he said, "Are those the guys?" I said, "Yeah." Here's what my brother did. He spread out his hands like this and ran to them. And he grabbed three or four of them and pushed them against a car. And he was beating them when within seconds, 15 or 20 other guys showed up. And I'm watching this and I'm thinking, this is a turkey shoot. I'm dead. But somebody shouted out, "The cops!" And they all went away. They flew, leaving me and my brother alone. So I always thank God for that day. I don't even know who shouted cops, but friends shield, protect, and defend friends. That's what they do. That was just an example of a friendship. Sometimes you're all alone. You don't have a brother or somebody else that could help you. You're alone. It's just you and whatever difficulty you're facing. And you need a friend. Proverbs 18:24 says, "A man that has friends must show himself friendly if you're going to keep them. And there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. There is a friend that loves you even before you knew you were loved. And like the song we sang, there's a friend who found you before you even knew you were lost. And that's Jesus. The power of his friendship. Because when you're alone and you need help, Jesus is there. He says, I'll never leave you. I will never forsake you. And there will be times when we are alone. There will be times when we don't know what to do. And there's nobody that we can call. There is nobody we can lean on. We got him, period. Just Jesus. And he's enough. Because he's the friend that sticks closer than a brother. Listen to this song clip.
And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has
treating ever people with respect. Allowing Jesus to walk with us when we're alone. Allowing Jesus to talk to us and we can talk to him. That's cultivating and strengthening a friendship. That's the kind of friend that sticks closer than a brother. He'll be there when we need him, and we will need him. Somebody may be thinking, all right, I don't need him today. You will tomorrow. There will always be a time when we need Jesus. And he's there. I want to share this with you. 30 years ago, a man and his son were sitting together in the kitchen. They were having breakfast. It was a normal day. And the father said something to his son that he said all the time. This is what he said. He said, son, I just want you to know that I'll always be there for you. He said that every day. And then he went off to school. And while he was in school, a devastating earthquake took place in Armenia. And 30,000 people perished. The father, realizing, ran to the school, which was now in rubble. And for the next 12 hours, he was removing bricks and cement, trying to find his son. 12 hours went by, 24 hours went by, and he was still removing rubble. After 36 hours, he found his son. And this is what his son said. He said, Dad, I knew you'd come. That's where the story ends. But I can tell you how the story is going to end after the end. That boy will always honor his father's values, will believe what his father believes, will trust what his father said. That's the kind of friendship that cements a relationship together. When you know somebody cares that much for you, that they would go out of their way, risk their lives, and search. And that is what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. He went all the way to Calvary. So it's no surprise that what Jesus believes, we will believe. When you understand what Jesus did, what Jesus' values are, they will be your values. What Jesus cares about, be what you care about, because he's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. I'd like to open up this altar as we sing an old hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. I'll be glad to pray with you. To bear, what a privilege to care. everything to God in prayer.